Since the earliest of civilizations, the night sky has fascinated human beings. For centuries, we've been dreaming of leaving our planet in hope of long-term survival, solving mysteries of existence, and experiencing adventures literally out of this world. At this point in the evolution of the human species, we are facing difficult issues like climate change and overpopulation, and it might just be too late to act to solve them. We may have come to a point where it is a matter of time until we exhaust crucial resources for energy production or even sustaining life itself. Multiple prominent thinkers, including Stephen Hawking and Elon Musk, agree that we might have a couple of millennia at most until we are forced to leave our home or go extinct. For our survival, at least in the near future, getting to Mars seems as a good bet. Greetings, Captain. We're headed towards Mars. Because of your invaluable personal skills, you've been chosen to lead humanity on an adventure unlike any other. On this journey, you will face many challenges, but ultimately, you will make history. If we want to successfully secure the heritage of civilization on Mars, you will have to satisfy these conditions. 1. You need to have a rocket that can carry you and your team, as well as the most important tools and resources. 2. You need to reach Earth's orbit. 3. You need to shift from Earth's orbit to orbit around Mars. 4. You need to successfully land on Mars. 5. You need to survive on Mars. Let's start with a rocket. For a mission to Mars, rockets with traditional propulsion systems would be a satisfying choice. It is believed that SpaceX's partially reusable Falcon 9 rockets will be used for the first manned missions to Mars. There are several different types of rockets. The most widely used thrusters are those that use liquid and solid fuel. Solid fuel boosters are much cheaper, but they are not as reliable as liquid fuel boosters because most of them cannot be shut down once started. If you remember the good old days of space shuttle launches. Solid rocket boosters were two white solid fuel engines attached to an orange external fuel tank. These engines were first attached in the process of staging. Staging is the process of getting rid of excess weight through detaching depleted parts of the spacecraft. Liquid fuel engines are more expensive than those powered by solid fuel, but at least we can manage the thrust of the rocket and have greater control over it. Except with SpaceX, we did not have a chance to see the use of liquid fuel engines in the first stage. In SpaceX's case, liquid oxygen and rocket-grade kerosene engines detached in the first stage land on special platforms, usually in the middle of the ocean, and can be used again. When we make rockets, we consider the weight of the propellant because it takes up a notable chunk of the rocket's overall weight. Then we need to consider the weight of the propellant needed to carry the propellant needed to power the rocket. There are many types of rocket engines, so we will not go into details surrounding them. In a nutshell, they work according to Newton's third law. For every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. Engines eject burning fuel at a great speed, which causes the rocket's motion in the direction opposite to the fuel ejection. When it comes to rocket engines, there is an important concept called thrust-to-weight ratio. In this case, because precision is crucial, thrust must be measured in controlled conditions and weight calculated from the gross weight at sea level. It should be pointed out that thrust-to-weight ratio must be greater than 1, which means for every 1 newton of weight, there must be more than 1 newton of thrust force so that rocket can fly. This further complicates things because in some cases more engines are needed, which means more propellant is needed, which means that weight of the spacecraft increases. Yeah, we feel ya. That's why rocket science is a source of countless memes and jokes across the web. As it was already mentioned, staging is the great way of getting rid of extra weight. Let's see an example of three-stage rockets that has a mass of 150 tons. First stage has 80, second stage has 40, and third stage has 30 tons. Each stage has its own engines and fuel tank. When propellant of the first stage is depleted, this stage is detached from the rocket, which loses its mass and thus weight drastically. The same goes for the second stage, until the third stage is reached when the rocket has a mass of 30 tons and is exempt from redundancy of carrying 2 empty fuel tanks and a dozen engines. It makes the rocket effective and efficient, but creates a problem of space junk, which is a story for another time. Let's get to the second, quite difficult part of the journey, getting into the orbit around our planet. The Earth has a strong gravity and a dense atmosphere, and both things drastically slow the rocket down. There must be a strong thrust and a lot of fuel so the rocket can leave the atmosphere. A rocket should be aerodynamic so it can deal with air resistance more easily. However, before we launch the rocket, we must make an agreement on when to do it. The easiest and most efficient way is to launch it before our planet is closest to Mars, so our spacecraft would reach its orbit just in time to land there. This includes calculating Earth-Mars phase angle, the angle between Earth and Mars relative to the Sun. This angle is around 30 degrees. The next time that phase angle is equal to 30 degrees will be in the year 2020. When we launched the rocket, we slowly tilted on the side so its orbit around Earth would be parallel to Mars' orbit around the Sun. The atmosphere ends at a height of around 70 kilometers, 43 miles, where we adjust the rocket so we can enter the orbit. We can imagine the orbit through the cannon analogy. Let's imagine a cannon shooting a projectile. After some time, the projectile will fall to the surface of the Earth. Now, let's imagine an extremely powerful cannon shooting a projectile. The projectile will fall to the surface at the other end of the globe, but let's imagine an even more powerful cannon. This time, the projectile is moving so fast that it will never fall to Earth's surface. The similar thing happens with our rocket. In relation to the center of mass, the farthest point of the orbit is called the apophis, and the nearest is the periapsis. The orbiting body is moving the slowest at apophis and fastest at periapsis. Oberth's effect states that the use of a rocket produces more energy at higher speeds, making it more effective and efficient to adjust the rocket's direction towards Mars at apophis and use the speed gained at periapsis to exit the orbit around Earth and finally embark on a journey to the red planet. If we did our burn correctly, our rocket is now going in the direction of Mars. Now we need to sit and wait for it to reach it. This is the most perilous part of the endeavor because our astronauts will be in a state of zero gravity, exposed to space radiation for 8 months, which can be detrimental to their overall health, as human bodies have evolved to be influenced by Earth's gravity and under protection from the sun's and other space radiation by our planet's magnetic field. To combat the latter, which is a huge issue for this type of mission, NASA is using nanotechnology to develop a new material called hydrogenated boron nitride nanotubes. Try saying that 3 times fast. Hydrogenated boron nitride nanotubes. Hydrogenated boron nitride nanotubes. Hydrogenated boron nitride nanotubes. Those could be quite effective shields from harmful cosmic radiation. After 8 months, we are very close to Mars. At Mars's periapsis, we do burn opposite of the direction of our movement. Vector opposite of the direction of movement is known as retrograde vector. After we do this burn, we enter orbit around Mars. These terms may be confusing, so we should clarify them. Let's imagine a rocket in orbit around Mars. If it does the prograde burn, or burn in the direction of movement, its height on the opposite side of Mars will be greater. If it does the retrograde burn, the height on the opposite side of the planet will be lower. The rocket that is going towards Mars is moving so fast that unless we do the retrograde burn, it won't enter the orbit around Mars, but continue to go deeper into space. We need to lower its speed through retrograde burn so it can enter the orbit. Let's get to landing on Mars. Now that you know what prograde and retrograde burns are for, we believe you can come up with the solution to land on Mars. We will do the opposite of what we did to enter the orbit. We will do the retrograde burn in a way that the height on the opposite side of the planet lowers to zero. Mars has around 40% of Earth's gravity, so the act of landing won't pose a great issue. While landing, we won't be able to use parachutes because the atmosphere on Mars is much less dense than Earth's atmosphere, so we'll have to slow down with our rocket engine. And finally, you will need to survive on the red planet. Mars is not suitable for human life at all. It has a very low level of oxygen, so you'll have to use spacesuits all the time. Gravity on Mars is relatively weak, so it could affect your bone density in a negative way. You'll have to produce oxygen, food, and water because they cannot be sent from Earth. Temperatures on Mars can get as low as 75 degrees below Celsius or 103 degrees below Fahrenheit. You and your team should be of superb physical health. Perhaps, more importantly, you should be of superb psychological health because you'll have to cope with loneliness, solitude, and the realization that you will likely never return to your original home and your loved ones. Nevertheless, you will become legends. The first astronaut on Mars will be the first human being to ever walk on another planet. You will be remembered until the end of history. It is an eternal human dream to touch the sky. This dream should not surprise us. We are stardust. We are children of stars. It is in children's nature to crave their parents. Reaching Mars is the first step towards embracing our parent. Good luck, Captain. We're sure that you will probably guide us on the first step of our greatest quest yet. Thanks for watching. Press like and share if you enjoyed this video. Subscribe for more of our content.